study of the Word of God. Dr. Ray?
Psalm 119, 105 says, Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Well, welcome to Word Studies. I am Dr. Ray, and I want to thank God for the opportunity to study with you the ever-living Word of God. Hebrews 4:12 says, For the Word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Welcome again to Word Studies. On this program, we study in depth the words of God. Recently, we have been studying on the pneumatikon. Pneumatikon, of course, is a Greek word for spiritual things, spiritual matters, things of the spirit in particular. As I said before, we're going to be looking at something that is perhaps off the beaten path for some of us, but we're going to look at it anyway. Why? Because it's in the Bible. And if you've got a Bible, we're going to be looking in the book of, why don't we look at 1 Samuel chapter 28? 1 Samuel chapter 28, and we're going to look at the very first king of Israel. Now, when I say he was the first king of Israel, that's probably not completely accurate, if you will, because God Almighty was actually the first king of Israel, except they rejected the Almighty, the creator of the universe, yes? The one who put all the stars out there, they rejected him as their king, and they wanted an earthly king, if you will, and that earthly king turned out to be Saul. Now, Saul initially had nothing to do with it as such. Saul was not a politician as such. He did not go out and campaign to be king, you know, like we campaign to be president, you know, or campaign to be governor, or campaign to be the mayor, or something like that. Well, Saul didn't do that. He was quasi, and I say quasi, chosen to be the first king of Israel because God was their king, but they seemed to not understand. They couldn't get it. We can't see our king. Yeah. We want to see our king just like all of the other nations in the land. Yeah. They have kings. They can see their kings. They can worship, if you will, bow down to their kings. Yeah. Well, they already had a king to worship. They just simply didn't know it. So they ended up with, as it were, an earthly king by the name of Saul, if you will. Okay, we're going to find out what happened to Saul, though, because God had made him, as it were, allowed Saul to become king of Israel. And then Saul disobeyed God. You know, many times when you're called into ministry, your responsibility is to obey God, yes, not man. I know many times we say, well, okay, then my members don't like that sermon, or the deacon board doesn't like that sermon, or perhaps this won't go over very good with the crowd or something of that nature. But now your responsibility as a pastor and or leader and or quote-unquote king, yes, is to obey God. Saul disobeyed God. Saul was commanded by God to kill everybody in the city that they were at war against. He told Saul to kill everybody, including the kings, the leaders, the whole, all of the cattle, and get rid of all of the gold and silver and everything. Saul did not follow God's orders. Yes. And then, of course, result of it was that God had removed Saul as king of Israel. And now Saul is still hanging around, so to speak. David is the king, but Saul has, you know, sometimes when you're in office, it takes a while for you to, the transfer of power, as it were, like when we get different presidents, you know, the other one that has been replaced is still in office until, the first of the year or something or other like that. Yeah, the first in January or something like that, the second president takes over. Well, this is in essence what is happening with Saul. Saul is still the king, but he has been deposed, as it were, by Almighty God. Now, you know, if God raises you up there, then he can bring you down, too. So many times that happens today. People are chosen by God to do certain things, and they disobey God. When you disobey God, well, perhaps God won't listen to you anymore. Notice what happened with Saul, if you will. Remember our question was, we had a question the last time that we were together. We said, can the living talk to the dead? That was what the question was. And we were about to discover whether or not it was possible. Okay? Now, in your Bible, you got a Bible? I'm going to read the scripture. In your Bible, we can turn to the book of 1 Samuel chapter 28. Notice, now Samuel had died. I think we covered that before, that Samuel had died. And all Israel had lamented over him. Okay? In other words, they had mourned over Samuel. Usually that mourning took at least a month for mourning time. I know in our culture, you know, you mourn one day, well, the person passed out. Okay, he's gone. Okay, well, let's start over with somebody else. Yeah. Okay. They took time. Notice 1 Samuel 28, verse 4. Then the Philistines gathered and came and encamped at Shunem. So Saul gathered all Israel together, and they encamped at Gilboa. Of course, Gilboa and Shunem were very close together. They could see each other, as a matter of fact. Okay? Okay. And Gilboa, when Saul saw the army of the Philistines, he was afraid, and his heart trembled greatly. And when Saul inquired of the Lord did not, notice, the Lord did not answer him. You know, that's a really delicate, difficult, bad situation to be in. If you pray to God and he does not answer, because God always answers prayer. Somebody asked me once, well, Dr. Ray, how do you know that God always answers prayer? 1 John 5:14 and 15. Did you ever read those scriptures? This is the confidence that we have in him being God, that if we ask anything that is according to his will, he hears us. Guess what? What Saul was asking was not according to God's will. Notice, the Lord did not answer him either by dreams or by Urim or by the prophets. In other words, all of the three different ways that God would answer, dreams, Urim. Urim, of course, was something that the high priest wore on the breastplate. Yeah, and they could take some of those things and they could sling them out there like dice, if you will. You gamble with God, you're going to lose because he knows it's going to come up 7 or 11 or whatever, snake eyes, yeah, if you're a gambler. But you know what those terms are. I learned them in the military. Not that I'm a gambler. I don't gamble. Yeah. Anyway, God knows what's going to happen. So therefore, the prophets and all of those back, the leaders in those days, who were listening to God and God was listening to them, they were able to gamble. They throw those things out there and whatever they came up, red, blue, white, green, either red with me, green with me, go, red with me, stop, don't go. Okay? Now, dreams. Did you ever dream anything? Everybody's had dreams, right? 99.9% of the dreams that you have, you don't remember, right? The only ones that you remember are dreams that actually mean something, or if they're from God. That's the way it was in Israel in those days. Dreams meant something, and if God, they had a dream, then God would reveal something to them in a dream. Saul was not getting any of those three mediums by which God would reveal to him, yeah, what to do. He didn't know what to do. What do I do, God? You know, it's what Saul is thinking. Well, God's not answering me anymore. You know, if you're a custom, as it were, for God to answer your prayer, and then all of a sudden he's not answering you, what do you do? Yeah? You know what the Bible says? Wait upon the Lord. Well, Saul was impatient. Yeah, he wasn't practicing what is written in the book of Galatians. Yes, we're supposed to have patience, aren't we? Yes, love, joy, peace, patience. Yeah, we're supposed to have patience. Saul didn't have it. So what does he do? Notice, if you will. Then Saul said to his servant, "Find me a woman who is a medium." Somebody asked me once about Dr. Ray, what's a medium? Yeah, a sorcerer. A sorcerer is a medium, or one who practices black magic, if you will. Yeah? Witches and so forth like that. Witchcraft, the practice of that. Yeah? That's what this medium woman did. Now, it says, find me a woman who is a medium. I need to point something out. That doesn't necessarily mean that there are only women that are in the witchcraft business, so to speak. Yeah? No. It simply means that women, I think I've said this before, women are more spiritually attuned, if you will, for lack of a better adjective, more spiritually attuned than men are. You know, in the old church days, when I say the old church days, say, I don't know, 100 years or so ago, and down even less than that, most churches or many churches have more women than men. You might think, okay, that's got to be some kind of, you know, just because women are weaker. That's not true. Spiritually speaking, women are stronger. Yes? Somebody said, well, how do you know that, Dr. Ray? Well, I could go back to the garden, if you will. The Garden of Eden, who was speaking to the serpent? Yeah, was it Adam or was it Eve? Yeah, it was Eve, right? Now, the serpent was, as it were, a spiritual entity, if you will, a spiritual entity, yes? And Adam kind of ignored it. You know, like today, men, I don't have to do with that preacher. I don't have anything with the Holy Spirit, or the Holy Ghost, as some people call it. You know? I don't have anything to do with that. Yeah, but women do. They tune in, as it were. Right? So, therefore, if there were evil spirits around, guess what? They were tuned in to women more readily than men. So, find me a woman who is a medium, that I may go to her, I'm reading again, and inquire of her. And his servant said to him, in fact, now, servants got to know, you know, if you're a servant, say, for instance, if you work for the president, you know, and the president needs a question answered, yeah, you got to be the answer. You got to be the guy that has the answer. You're going to get promoted, right? I got the answer, yeah? Notice, I'm reading again. So Saul disguised himself. Let me back up. And his servant said to him, in fact, there is a woman who is a medium at Endor. Now, Endor was a little small place that was close to Israel, but on the outskirts, if you will, because Saul had cast all the mediums, all the witchcraft, all of the sorcerers, all those people out of Israel, okay? But this woman was kind of hanging on to the, in the suburbs, if you will, yeah? She was still there. She said, well, perhaps somebody over there might want a reading or something, yeah? Like we have these psychics on TV, you know, I think at one time they put all psychics off TV. Yeah, but now periodically you can fine-tune your radio or your TV and you can find a psychic. Yeah, well, Saul knew, he's a king, and his servants knew there's this woman in Endor. So Saul disguised himself. Verse 6, is that verse 6? Yeah, disguised himself and put on other clothes, and he went, and two men with him, and they came to the woman by night, and he said, please conduct a seance. You know what a seance is? Yeah. If you don't know what a seance is, I think I've explained it before, but you know, many times I say the same thing over and over and over and over. Have you ever wondered why I say the same things over and over and over and over? Tony said, because you got that you said them before, Dr. Ray. That's why you're saying them over again. No, that's not the reason why. The reason why is because faith, as it were, in the Bible, yeah, The Bible says faith comes by hearing, right? Hearing, that's present participial. That means you're hearing it over and over and over and over and over and over, and you're building up your faith, yes? It's like building up your muscles. You know, you go out and you lift one weight in the gym, and you say, okay, now I'm as strong as Superman. No, that's not right. You got to keep on lifting over and over and over, and finally, yeah, you'll start seeing results, right? Same thing with hearing the Word of God. When you're hearing the Word of God, you're lifting a spiritual weight, as it were, yeah? And you're building up your faith. Now, that's why I say things over and over and over again. Notice, look, the woman, I'm in verse 6. Is that verse 6 or verse 9? Why don't I put on these gafas? You know the Spanish word for glasses is gafas? Yeah, some of you may know that, and you may have another Spanish word for glasses, right? The one I know is gafas. So I'm going to put on my gafas because of reading. That's verse 9, not verse 6. Then the woman said to him, look, you know what Saul has done. He has cut off The medium, the spirit is from the land. Why then do you lay a snare for my life to cause me to die? In other words, you say, hey, say, wait a minute here, you know. I'm in trouble with the king if I do any of this seancing stuff. Yeah, I can't do that. We've been instructed not to do it. But notice Saul. Saul swore to her by the Lord. This is verse 10, saying, as the Lord lives, no punishment shall come upon you for this thing. In other words, Saul said, oh, you know what? I know I made the rule, but I'm breaking my own rule. Now, that's already a problem, isn't it? You make a rule and you break your own rule. It would be like God breaking his own rule, right? No, you're saved, but when you get to heaven, well, brother or sister, I think I changed my mind about you. You didn't do enough Hail Marys down there. You know, go down and do a few more or something. He would break his own rule, right? That's not his rule. Notice. Then the woman said, whom shall I bring up for you? Remember, we were saying, can the dead talk to the... I wanted to say, can the dead talk to the dead? But can the dead talk to the living? Yeah, this is what Saul wants to do. He wants to talk to Samuel, and Samuel is dead. Yeah, buried and dead. Yeah. Where is Samuel after Samuel died in those days? Where did Samuel go? Did he go to heaven? Did he go to hell? Well, where was he? Yeah. That Saul could contact him. Where was Samuel at? Yeah. Well, Saul wanted to have an answer to the same question. Well, yeah, not only do I want to know where he's at, I want to bring him back so I can talk to him. I got a problem, man. You know, I got all these Philistines all around me, right? I don't know where David is either. Yeah. No. Remember, David had slain Goliath, but I can't even find that little short guy that killed the big giant. So he's looking for Samuel. Notice, when the woman saw Samuel, now she had called up Samuel. Now, somebody said to me, well, how can she do that, Dr. Ray? Well, it's not God. I can tell you that right now, right? It's not the will of God. So if somebody wants to get the idea that, well, I'm saying that, well, yeah, we can do this. No, you can't do it. Not and be in the will of God. You can do it and be outside the will of God, yeah? So how is it that this woman was able to bring up Samuel, who had died? Yes, notice. Now, I'm reading scripture. Somebody said, well, did you write this stuff, Dr. Ray? But no, I didn't write it. I'm not a writer as such. But notice, I can read. I'm a reader. Yeah. Notice, when the woman saw Samuel in verse 12, she cried out with a loud voice, and the woman spoke to Saul, saying, why have you deceived me? For you are Saul. Now, I had a question. How did she know that he was Saul when she had not seen him because he was disguised? All she saw was Samuel. Well, okay. So I said, do you have the answer to that question, Dr. Ray? I believe I can give you my answer. You don't have to take this for, this is how the Bible says, but I can give you my answer why I believe that this medium, woman, sorcerer, knew that it was Saul after she saw Samuel, because she knew that Samuel was Saul's prophet, if you will. And Samuel was the one who had anointed Saul King of Israel. She knew all these things. You know, mediums know something. I mean, if you're dealing with the devil has been around for how many years? Do you know how old the devil is? Somebody asked me that question last year. How old's the devil, Dr. Ray? You know, I don't know how old he is. He's older than I am. I know that. Yeah. But I don't know exactly how old he is. And I don't know of anybody, yeah, who would know the age of the devil except God Almighty, right? He's the one who created him, right? And he's been around for a while. Okay. So, therefore, the devil knows some stuff simply by being here. It's like if you live to be 127, 137, 100, let's see. Abraham lived to be 175 years old, right? But Abraham had to learn something at 175 years. You know, I mean, after all, just hanging around. It's like people who hang around the church. They're not believers. They're not non-believers. They're just agnostics, I guess. But they hang around the church. Well, if you hang around there, you're going to learn something, aren't you? I mean, you're not just going to be there and don't know anything. because the preacher is preaching. Yeah. They're having Bible studies. You show up at all of those things. You don't believe any of it, but you know what they said, yeah, just by hanging around. Well, that's the way the devil is. You know, he's been around. So therefore, he knows what you're going to do on a set of circumstances. Let me get back to the scripture. Notice verse 13, and the king said to her, "Do not be afraid. What did you see?" He didn't even know what she had seen. She had seen Samuel, and he didn't even know it because she hadn't told him yet. Okay? And she said, and oh, notice this scripture. Do you have a Bible? I'm not making stuff up as I go along, because some people, you know, sometimes people will think the preacher made that part up, you know, to make it sound good, right? That's not so. I'm simply reading scripture. Notice. And she said, an old man is coming up, and he is covered with a mantle. What does it mean to be covered with a mantle? I guess you know what it means to be an old man, right? Older than 37, perhaps. Yeah. An old man is coming up, and he is covered with a mantle. What does it mean to be covered with a mantle? Right? Okay. If you know the answer, you can call me. Yeah. Call me at the end of the program and tell me. So after the program goes off the air, you can tell me. He's covered with a mantle. Yes. A mantle means that he's a prophet. In other words, and she knew that when she saw the mantle, that it had to be Samuel. Hadn't been dead for, you know, 10 years. It hadn't been that long that Samuel had passed on, right? So therefore, she knew that Samuel was a prophet. And if you had a mantle on you, that meant you were a prophet. And Saul perceived, notice he didn't see him, and Saul perceived that it was Samuel, and he stooped down with his face to the ground and bowed down. Saul had imminent, if you will, respect for Samuel, because Samuel had bailed him out of a lot of problems that they had, you know, with the Philistines. He didn't have David to kill all the Philistines or Goliath. Now, somebody asked me once, Dr. Ray, was Goliath the only large giant? It's a large giant. Was the only big, tall giant? You know, like Goliath was like 9 feet tall. Yeah. Wide as two doors. Yeah, this is true. Not a fabrication. He was 9 feet tall, wide as two doors, right? And well, he had armor bearers. He had his own people walking in front of him, deflecting arrows and stones and whatever they were throwing after him, so it didn't hit him. Now, you wonder about the guys who were the armor bearers. You know, they were in big trouble because they were trying to protect this big 9-foot-tall giant. Notice. Okay. And Saul did not have David around to do anything for it. Now, Samuel said to Saul, "Why have you disturbed me by bringing me up?" Now, I got a question for you. Now, Samuel himself said that Saul had brought him from the dead. Yeah, if you will. Okay. I'm just reading this. Now, Samuel said to Saul, "Why have you disturbed," notice, underline the word disturbed, "me by bringing me up?" Now, Saul is talking to a dead man, right? I said, could the living talk to the dead? Saul is. Now, okay, let me rephrase that. Because if you were saying, okay, my great-great uncle passed on and I want to talk to him, you can go out and talk all you want to. He's not going to say anything back, right? No, he's not going to speak back to you. And that's not the way God wants it, because if it was, why wouldn't we all be doing it? Yes? If it was, in fact, the will of God. Outside of the will of God. Don't do it. Don't try it. Don't. Look, bad stuff is going to happen to Saul as a result of what he's doing. Notice. And Saul answered. Saul is answering Samuel. And Saul answered, "I am deeply distressed, for the Philistines make war against me, and God has departed from me and does not answer me anymore, neither by prophets nor by dreams." In other words, God is ignoring. Have you ever felt that God was ignoring you? You know, you say, "I've been praying about this thing for months and months and months, you know, and I haven't heard anything from God. Is he ignoring me?" Perhaps. Now, I'm going to put a word, the word perhaps. I don't particularly like the word perhaps, but I have to use it. Perhaps you're praying outside of the will of God. Do you believe that you can pray outside of the will of God? Easily. Yeah? You can pray outside of the will of God. What is God's will concerning prayer? Yeah? His word, yeah? His word is his will. If you know the word of God, you know the will of God, yeah? And you won't be praying outside of the will of God. Now, let me amplify on that, if you will, for lack of a better way of putting it. You can pray outside of the will of God even though you know what the will of God is, yeah? Also, you can do that. This is what Saul is doing. He's praying. He's operating, if you will, outside of the will of God. And God, of course, had decided not to speak, not to answer any prayer coming from Saul. And I know a lot of people say, well, he didn't answer mine either, Dr. Ray. I've been praying for a Cadillac for 25 years. I still got this Ford pickup truck in my driveway. Okay, notice, you're praying outside of the will of God, like Saul. And the Lord has done for himself. Notice, then Samuel, back up to verse 16. Then Samuel said, so why do you ask me? If God doesn't answer you, why are you asking me? Well, you think I can supplement God? Yeah. Why are you asking me? Seeing the Lord has departed from you and has become your enemy. Do you think that God will ever become your enemy? If you keep on disobeying God, disobeying, is that a word, disobey? Disobeying God, yeah, he's becoming your enemy. You don't want to make God your enemy, yeah. God, you want God to be your friend. He was a friend of Abraham, notice. And the Lord has done for himself, in verse 17, and he spoke by me, for the Lord has torn the kingdom out of your hand and given it to your neighbor. Can you imagine God taking your Cadillac and giving it to your neighbor? You've been praying for a Cadillac for 25 years, and your neighbor shows up with a brand new one in his driveway. Yeah. He says, okay, God took my Cadillac. Cadillac is my own personal Hebrew word for Cadillac. Took my Cadillac and gave it to my neighbor. This is in essence what has happened to Saul. He'd given it to your neighbor, and he named him. Yeah, normally God didn't name names. Remember, he didn't name Judas's name, but his name is David. I've given it to your neighbor, David. Now, I guess I would suppose, well, I know, that did not sit too good with Saul. And he told him why. You know, when God does something, he tells you why he did it. He doesn't leave you hanging. You're like some people, you'll meet your friend or boss or whoever. One morning, he'll speak to you. Hi, hello. Hello, Dr. Ray. How you doing? Shake your hand. Yeah, it's great to see you. You know, that's beautiful red and green tie that you have on there. Yeah. And the next morning you meet him, it's like you're not there. You become invisible. Yeah. Have you ever done that? Yeah. In essence, this is what happened to Saul. Okay. Now, I'm almost through. You know, my name is Dr. Ray, in case you wonder, well, who is that preacher? You know, my name is Dr. Ray, and we're looking here in the Bible, in the scripture, you know, because people ask this question, can you talk to those who have passed on? Yeah? Well, okay, you can, but you can't. Is that an answer? You can, but you can't. That sounds like neither here nor there. I remember when I was in college, I had a professor that was always saying it's neither here nor there. In the Bible, there's no such thing as neither here nor there. Okay, my name is Dr. Ray, in case you're wondering, well, who is that preacher? We have a church that's located at 4153 Overland Avenue, Culver City, California. We have a service there every Sunday morning, 9 a.m. until 10:30 a.m. So, if you're in the area, if you fly in here and you say, well, you know what, I don't know anybody who goes to church. Yeah. And I don't know what church to go to. I might end up in a Church of the Living Dead or something or other like that. Well, no. You can come by and visit with us there because we're centrally located. We're close to Disneyland. We're close to Knott's Farm. Yeah. 4153 Overland Avenue. This program has-
has been a blessing to you and your family or has helped you in any way, please feel free to write to us and pray for us. Remember also, we need and appreciate your financial support. Please send your financial gifts and love offerings to Dr. Ray Winston at P.O. Box 1173, Culver City, California, 90232. That's Dr. Ray Winston, P.O. Box 1173, Culver City, California, 90232. You also may call Dr. Ray at area code 310-559-8320 or 800-747-8320. Remember also, God loves a cheerful giver.